We begin. Thank you all very much for coming. I think we're in for a very interesting event this afternoon. First, let me introduce myself. My name is William Sposato. I am a freelance journalist here in Tokyo and a member of the FCCJ. I've been here since 1996, working for Wall Street Journal, Reuters, and now freelance writer. But that's not important. The important thing is obviously our speakers here today. So to start off with the basic line, it's the economy, stupid. That was a famous line, for those of you who think I've just insulted you, apologies, from Mr. James Carville when he was managing the highly successful presidential campaign of Bill Clinton, saying that it's the economy that matters the most. Indeed, the fact that we have over 50 people here today, I think, proves that. Prime Minister Abe has himself said countless times that the economy is the number one issue before he then goes off into other subjects. So to look at where we stand for 2016 and what the prospects are, we are very lucky to have two distinguished economists with us. Right to my right is Mr. Kanno, Masaaki Kanno of JP Morgan, where he is the chief economist and managing director for Japan. Prior to the current post, he held a number of roles at the Bank of Japan, including being in charge of the FX department. So if Reuters or Bloomberg are here, they will no doubt ask you about exchange rates so they can get a snap out of the news. To my farther right is Mr. K. Long. He is a senior fellow at the Fujitsu Research Institute, which I'm sure many of you are familiar with as a leading think tank for economic research. He has been there since 1998 and specializes in development finance and the Chinese economy. So we're going to have a little bit of Japan and then a little bit of China. I think both are obviously very timely. The Chinese economy, I don't need to discuss. Everyone sees it every day in the news media. So a couple of things before we start. Number one, turn off your mobile phones. Yes, do it now. Otherwise, you will embarrass yourselves hugely as we go through the event. Each of our speakers is going to speak for about 20 minutes. We will then take questions first from the working press and then from the broader audience here. So with no further delay, may I ask Mr. Kanno to please kick us off. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much for giving a great opportunity in front of such a distinguished guest today. And I think my role is to talk about Japan macro and also policies. Okay, so in this context, let me go through my presentation. And the first page is just a summary of what I should say today. And naturally, the Japanese economy tends to be affected by the global economy, and especially the China and Asian economies. So let me just start talking about how we look at the global economy in 2016. Our baseline is that the global economy will grow around the trend growth rate. Although this is not such a great story, and in the past, when an economy is in an expansionary phase, the economy tended to grow much faster than the trend growth rate or potential growth rate. But in the current the cycle, unfortunately, the economy failed to have such a great performance, but just in line with the trend growth rate. And 2016 is likely to just follow the previous trend that started in 2009. But obviously, if you look at what happened in the past week or 10 days, we have had lots of the surprisingly negative news from Middle East, China, North Korea, and also the stock market. And so definitely, the recent movement of the market is challenging our view. So therefore, I would say the risk is skewed to the downside. But then in the details, still we believe that the developed economies, DM, should perform better than the EMs, the emerging economies. And the emerging economy economies have the big problems of on the credits, the credit side. The debt accumulation is a basic problem they are facing. And as you know, that the U.S. The Fed started to hike rates, and our renminbi devalued. So this is not a favorable situation, especially for Asian emerging economies. So how the emerging economy would perform this year, and needs to be closely watched. And coming to Japan, and we believe that the Japanese economy will grow on average slightly above 1% this year. And as Japan's potential growth rate is 0.3% according to the BOJ and 0.4% according to the government or cabinet office. So if we achieve the 1%, above 1% growth, I guess that would be great. And in our view, the consumption is likely to be the main driver of the growth of the Japanese economy this year, although the consumption disappointed 2014 and 15. And I'll tell you more detail why, but basically real income situation would be more favorable this year thanks to the decline in oil prices. And also the CapEx is another driver. But the CapEx will grow, but only modestly in our views. Although the corporations accumulated the cash, but they don't have a great incentive to spend in Japan. And this is mainly because they don't seem to have the great other investment opportunities in Japan. Although the Abe administration has tried hard to convince them to invest to increase the investment in Japan, but Japanese corporations didn't seem to be convinced by the Abenomics yet. And I think the main issue is still the lack of the growth of the domestic demand based on the persistent decline in the populations. So in Abenomics, what the government is trying to do is to increase the productivities to offset the population trend or the negative impact from the demographics. But what we should expect from the growth of the productivity is likely to be limited. And actually, this is unfortunately a global trend. Even in the U.S., productivity growth rate is falling. And it's very hard to cope with the global trend. And naturally, one of the important agenda ahead of us is the reform of the two areas, labor market and the social securities. Those are said to be the bedrock regulations, but especially I'd like to focus on the labor reform as the number one issue that the Abe administration needs to tackle this year. There'll be an upper house election in July, and there may be the double election. I think the odds that there'll be a double election, which means both the upper house and lower house election will be held, are quite high. And if that is the case, there is unlikely to be a big announcement from the government until the summertime, because these reforms are particularly unpopular in Japan. And because the people themselves have the vested interests in the current the regulations or the current framework. But after the election, and especially if there is the double election, and the result is obvious, and the ruling parties will win. I don't know how much they get the seats in both upper and lower house. But anyway, they will win. But especially if in this case. And Abe will have another 4 years of the Abe administration. So that basically, at least in theory, Abe can have the very unpopular policies shortly after the election. Although I'm not so sure whether my dream will come true or not, but I hope that Abe will make make a decision to implement those unpopular policy, especially the labor market reforms. And I think that those are not so small. Just based on my personal information I collected from the government's people. And another interesting issue is that how the BOJ will play in the current environment. As you know, that still the BOJ says that 2% inflation will be or should be achieved by end of the second half of the by the end of the fiscal year 2016, basically by March 2017, and we don't share the BOJ's view. And at the earliest, it's very hard to achieve the 2% inflation anytime so soon. And especially when yen stops weakening, and probably by middle of this year, it'll be clear that the BOJ will give up the current commitment of achieving the 2% inflation by the end of fiscal year 2016, or it could happen as soon as in January, in 10 days, and in the next board meeting. And at that time, it could happen in January, but we don't think at the moment, but it's just a matter of time that the BOJ will announce additional easing and in order to maintain its credibility. So at the moment, in December, as we didn't know that the stock prices fell, stocks are sold off and the yen strengthened. So at that time, we thought the BOJ's additional easing will come and in the second half of this year. But now the odds are rising that it could happen in the first half of the year. But the key is the yen, the dollar yen. So if the dollar yen falls to below 115, then the government and the BOJ together would have to take an action to stop it. Why 115? Because according to the BOJ's the Tankan survey, the exporters assumed dollar yen in their the profit projection is 118. So which basically means that half of the exporters assume the 115, and the other half assume 120. So if the dollar yen falls to below 115, all the exporters would have to revise down their profit forecast. Naturally, this is bad for the stock market, and also this could be the trigger to the downward spiral of both stock prices and the yen. And it's very hard to pinpoint when, but the BOJ will have to announce the easing and further easing and to stop the vicious cycle. What the BOJ can do, I still believe that the BOJ can buy more JGBs and ETF and J-REIT. But there is some limit. And although, there are some misunderstanding among the even economists and analysts in Japan. And basically, to answer how much more the BOJ can buy the JGBs, we need to refer to the prices or the bond yield. In other words, if the BOJ accepts the negative bond yield, then actually the BOJ can buy more and more JGBs. But to the extent this is unrealistic, then the BOJ would have to give up the purchasing the JGBs if the bond yield comes down to some threshold. I don't know whether the threshold is maybe the 10 basis point or zero or maybe even below that. But anyway, so what the BOJ can do after that? And naturally the BOJ may be able to buy more ETFs, stocks, but that is also have some limit. So then after that, BOJ may have to think of cutting the IOER, interest rate on excess reserves. But the cutting the IOER would have the adverse impacts on Japanese banks' profitability. So that it will destabilize the Japanese banking system, and it may be deflationary rather than inflationary. So the BOJ is in a very difficult position. But as Kuroda has a very strong will to achieve the 2% inflation in a limited time the line, So the BOJ needs to do more and more, and otherwise the risk is the stronger yen and falling stock prices. And also the last one is the wage rate. So the wage rate is a key, will play a key role in Japan's macroeconomic the outlook, because without a rise in the wage rate, the consumption will not grow. Originally, some monetarists would have thought that if the inflation expectation rises, then the consumption should increase because the people will buy the goods and services before prices rise. But it did not happen. So the key role is an increase in incomes. So therefore, the wage rate must hike. And also, in order to achieve the higher inflation rate, the wage rate must rise fast enough. But unfortunately, this year, outlook is not so great. And last year, the wage rate hike at the Shunto was 0.6-0.7% in 2015. And 2014, it was 0.4. And 2013, it was 0. So it changed from 0, 0.4, 0.7. So I would have thought it should be 1 this year. It's easy. Even a grammar school student can say it should be 1 this year. But unfortunately, the Japanese labor unions are quite modest. Their target of the base salary hike that we call base up is likely to be below the last year's level. So I think the media seems to have too much focus on the result of the wage rate hike at the Shunto. But as an economist, I would say we should focus on more basic the demand and supply situation in the labor market. Definitely, the labor market is being tightened. So eventually, the wage rate will be hiked, and even without the pressure from the government. But basically, the wages are very sticky. And we should expect the continued increase in wages. But it takes time. Therefore, my view is that the BOJ will not have a 2% inflation anytime so soon. But eventually, we will have the 2% inflation or above 2% inflation. And as wage rate is likely to be hiked, and based on just reflecting the tightness of the labor market. Because of the limit of the supply of the labors, so maybe Japan will surprise the rest of the world by having the above 2% inflation eventually, even while the rest of the world are suffering from the lack of the inflation. Because Japan fell into deflation first. In those days, probably the rest of the world thought Japan is the exception. But what happened is obvious. Now the global economy is suffering from the lack of the inflation or maybe suffering from some sign of deflation. So in this sense, I'm a believer that Japan is a front runner. And so Japan will be able to have above 2%, mainly because of the further tightening of the labor market. But wage rate growth is so limited, it's because of the mismatches in the labor market. In my view, actually, the labor market is not tightened enough. I can show you some chart, but I don't think I have enough time. And I show you that one of the tables shows that there's a big mismatch in the labor market in Japan. And the last one is a dollar yen. I think the dollar yen, the peak of the dollar yen is already behind us. And based on our calculation, the dollar yen is overvalued historical extent. But in the near term, still we believe that the Fed will try to hike the rates. And also to the extent the U.S. doesn't mind the strong dollar. So basically, the story of the strong dollar will be dominant. So the Japan and the Europe will get the benefit from that. But someday after Fed hikes the rates a couple of times or several times, then probably the Fed will have to cut the rate. And it is just simply the business cycle. And as you know, that the U.S. economy continued to recover for 6 years and a half now. And the longest period of the U.S. economic recovery was 10 years in 1990s. So the J.P. Morgan has a view that the probability of the U.S. economy falling into recession in 3 years is 70 to 80%. So in 3 years, it is likely, or the odds are not so small, that the U.S. economy will fall into recession. So if you hear the weather forecast, today it will rain with a probability of 70 or 80%, probably you will take an umbrella with you. So this is where we are. So my story is 3 years late, 3 years or maybe 4 years, that if the Fed starts to cut the rates, so that Japan will suffer a lot with the very strong yen. And there is a big downside, not in the near term, but eventually the yen will get strengthened tremendously. And this is also just the story of the cycles. And after that, yen will get weak, and because we know how to end the yen weakness, because the BOJ has done a great job, so the BOJ should do the same thing if the yen strengthens, then we know how to get out of this. Of it. And also, if you give me just 5 minutes, and I'd like to go straight through the chart. The first is actually the story of the consumption. As you know, that on the left-hand chart, this is a correlation of the income and consumption in real terms. So the reason why the consumption disappointed was the decline of the real incomes. And also, naturally, on top of that, the payback from the front-loading consumption before the consumption tax rate hike was much bigger than expected. But the drugs just disappeared. And now the real income is growing at around, say, 1.5 to 2%. And also, the right-hand chart shows now the propensity to consume is very stable in the long run. So unless the consumers get a shock, and we should expect some stabilized the propensity to consume, which basically suggests that the real consumption should grow in line with the incomes. Okay, and the income should grow 1.5% or so. So the real consumption should grow 1.5% or so. Okay, and this is basic. And also, look at the wage rate statistics are very noisy, but the underlying trend is the modest increase. Please focus on this blue line. This is a scheduled earnings of the contract wages. This is what we call the base salary. And as you look at the right-hand chart, the main source of an increase of employment is the part-timers. The hourly wage of the part-timer is less than half of the full-timers. So what we are seeing is an increase of the low-wage earners. So that depresses the wage rate. So don't focus too much on the wage rate. Main source of the income is employment in Japan. And this is the evidence of the success of Abenomics. And as shown here, the labor participation, long-term trend of the labor participation rate is down the downside until the 2013. As soon as Abe became the prime minister, the labor participation rate rebounded, and the female and the elder people finally came back to the labor force. So this is a great, there's good evidence of the success of Abenomics. This I told you. And so this table shows the source of the mismatches in the labor market. And the media quite frequently quotes that there is a very severe labor shortage in the construction industries. It's true that the job offers to applicant ratio is 3.0. And the monthly average of job offer is 92,000, but applicants is 31,000. So that's why the ratio is three times. But if you look at the general office workers, the ratio is only 0.27. The annual supply, the monthly job offer is 126K, while the number of the applicants is 474K. Actually, the total The number of the applicants is about 2,000K or 2 million a month. So the nearly 25% of the workers are classified as general office workers. And there is still the redundancies in these areas. Actually, who are the general office workers? Those are the people who don't have any special skills. So the problem in Japan is that there are not so many the skilled workers. I mean, people who have some specific skills. And and also those people, probably the young mothers coming back to the labor force and the retired people who are looking for some job, are now the classified as the general office workers. And so this is the main reason why the wage growth rate is so limited. But eventually, we are likely to see the number of the applicants here will fall tremendously. And because in 3 years, all the first baby boomer generations will reach 70 years old, I don't think that they like to work so hard. And eventually, due to a decline of the number of the applicants, even the job offered applicant ratio for general office workers would increase. So that's why I strongly believe that although it takes more than 3 years, the tightening of the labor market will push up the wage rate, and this is how we will have the 2% inflation. And although I didn't have time to talk about the corporations, and this shows that the cash flow is the aggregate of the corporate profit after tax plus depreciation. And this surged and last year, and finally it exceeded the pre-Great Recession era's peak. And this blue line, it shows the CapEx, and the CapEx is growing, but only modestly. So the gap between the yellow line and the blue line, that is a green line on the right-hand chart, is surging. And but the corporations don't seem to spend money, they just hoard and increase the deposit at the banks. But banks don't have a great opportunity to increase bank lending. So the banks buy the JGBs. And those JGBs held by the banks are bought by the BOJs. In other words, money finally goes back to the BOJ's vault. So then the money does not circulate to stimulate the economy. So that's a big problem. So the government should make more effort to deregulate and cutting the corporate tax rate to increase the investment opportunities. And the Abe administration tries hard to convince the corporations to spend money on the CapEx and the wages. That is not bad. But what the government should do is to make progresses in deregulation. So this is a primary object of the Abe administrations. So this is our price outlook. The focus on this green part, this is a core contribution of the core CPI inflation rate. We think that even a core CPI inflation rate will be peaking out soon, mainly because of the disappearance of the impact from the weak yen. And the left-hand chart is very interesting because although I don't believe that the 2% inflation will be achieved anytime so soon, but at the same time, we are seeing early sign of the genuine inflation in Japan. Where can we find it? It's in the food. And look at this left-hand chart. Basically, the food prices at retailers reflect a rise or fall in import cost. Basically, that is strong yen or weak yen. But since April last year, those two lines started to diverge. And this basically means that the food prices started to rise more than justified by the weakening of the yen. And interestingly, finally, the consumers accepted it, a rise in inflation. So this is an early sign of the rise in inflation. And and also reflecting it, the profit margin of the food companies in Japan started to rise. So the stock prices of the food companies are relatively okay. And because there is a lot of the innovations in the food industries, especially compared with some other part of the world. And when we go to the supermarket, we see the new product. And if you buy, say, canned beer, and we have a different canned beer, winter, spring, summer, and autumn. And I don't think that we can see the same thing in the other part of the world, only Japan. But I'm not so sure this is a good example or not. But anyway, so this
for this crowd, I think it's very useful.
So this is very innovative. I think the Japanese food industry is very competitive. And also, we don't have the great amount, large amount of the import of the processed foods from Asia. But the situation is opposite. Actually, the food industry can be another Japan's the leading industry, maybe next to autos, especially when Japan's electronic industries lost the competitiveness. So the role of the food industry is very important. And so this is the probability of the BOJ's the easing, and 30% January, 40% April, 50% July, and 80% November. And... right, maybe that's it for me.
Okay, no, that's very good. That's a fact-packed presentation. Thank you very much, very interesting. I'm sure some of the issues that you touched on our reporters will want to ask you more about in the Q&A session. So thank you very much for that. Kei-san, let us move to you. And where are you going to take us, to China directly, or let's see where we're going. We'll have a technical timeout. Okay, I think we're set, right? Yeah. Don't show it all. No, it's a secret. No one look. Please. This is
mine.
There we go. Okay. Over to you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Chairman. I'm very glad to have an opportunity here to make a presentation on my personal view on Chinese economy. And before make presentation, I just like make a short comment on what Mr. Kanno-san presented in his speech. Well, I think that the first, Abenomics, the old policy mix, it's very, efficient to, just support economic development, because the BOJ generated so a huge amount of liquidity. It's good, but I don't think that a BOJ can continues to generate liquidity like the government request. I think Japan now facing a very serious risk that BOJ need to do more effort to maintain independence as a central bank. I think that the great point that Mr. Kanno mentioned, deregulation. I think Japanese government need to do more effort to improve deregulation and to strengthen competition. Otherwise, maybe Japanese economy could going to slow down at the second half of this year. Anyway, I think Abe administration need to, announce the detail about the new policy mix. They cannot just show us the goal. We just need to want how to realize the goal. So this is the risk on Abenomics. From now on, let make a presentation on Chinese economy. it's very Happy New Year, but I don't think it's a, maybe it's not a Happy New Year for Chinese political leaders, even for Japanese policymakers like Abe-san and Aso-san. It's not a Happy New Year. You know, the Nikkei declined over 600 points today. So what happened now in China? Nobody know. Many advisors and economists in Beijing, they usually, you know, tell Xi Jinping and Li Keqiang, Chinese Prime Minister, Chinese economy have no a problem. Just you know, could sustain 7 to 8% GDP growth rate. So. Today, I just want to focus that, on what happened now in China. Actually, 2016, this year, Chinese economy and China, the country, just facing a very huge uncertainty. How to manage the risks, it's a big point here. When we argue on uncertainties, actually, there's a lot of risks. Here, I just want to show you some big risks. In the short-term view, I think we need to focus on the economic bubble, the property market and stock exchange market, for example. My view is that whether China can make the bubble soft landing, otherwise, China need to reform the market and need to reform the state-owned enterprises. And from a long-term view, I think that China will, you know, face some big risk, that is a political risk. The political risk, that means the monopoly political system just make you know, corruption very seriously. Deng Xiaoping, the former leader, he started to reform the economic system, but he refused to reform the political system. So this is a negative legacy for Chinese society. The point here is that whether Xi Jinping can you know, make a decision to start to reform the political system. Otherwise, Chinese economy will, you know, going to slow down. Maybe will have a, you know, a crisis. The second point here is the environmental pollution. I think everybody know or concern on the PM2.5. Actually, when we take a look at environmental pollution, the point not only PM 2.5, but also, for example, water pollution. It's very, very serious. 2 years ago, actually, I just went back to China to do research every month. But about 2 years, in the past 2 years, I just went back to China two or three times because I'm just very concerned on my, you know, personally healthy. The PM 2.5 is very, very serious, seriously. Why Chinese environment pollution come to be so serious? I think the moral hazard of the government and the moral hazard of the enterprises, even the moral hazard of the ordinary people, is the you know, the real reason of the problem. The third point here is the income disparity. Actually, the income disparity is not you know, considerable under a socialism system, but actually, in the past 3 decades, the income gap comes to be so huge. So how to overcome the income disparity? This is a very important point for Chinese government and Chinese society. Well, let's just review Chinese economic model at first. About the demand side, you know, Chinese economy just sustained the development, just to rely on the investment and export. But the consumption, especially the private consumption, is very weak. About 3 years ago, Premier Li Keqiang announced again that China need to encourage the private consumption, but actually it's not easy. And about the supply side, you know, the capital and the set is very huge now. Many of the companies, especially the state-owned enterprises, they hold so huge amount of overcapacity. How to reduce overcapacity is a very important point here. And the second point here is the labor. The population actually is going to decline maybe next year. So to overcome the decline of the population, China need to improve innovation to strengthen the productivity and efficiency. But actually, we did some researches in China. We find that the Chinese enterprises, especially about state-owned enterprises, they don't pay attention to do innovation. I think this is another structural problem for China. Well, this is a Chinese economic data. We can see that the GDP growth rate declined in the past 5 years. I think the main problem is that the private consumption is still very weak. So when we argue something about the economic data, usually, somebody will ask me that the Chinese GDP data is believable or not. Actually, I do not like to answer this question because it's very dangerous for me. This is the official data. I just tell you it's not believable. Okay, but the problem here is how the government just changed the GDP data. I just show you one case. The problem is actually is not about the GDP data. The CPI could be important. Is a problem, I think. Because the real GDP equaled, normal GDP minus CPI. So the government usually show us the CPI as a very small amount. Okay, for example, in China, that the CPI last year is about 1.4%. But let's account that it's 2%, for example. So, okay, the nominal GDP account 9%. Well, the real GDP will record 7%. But actually, in China, this is the real weight of a CPI index. What's the problem here? You can find that the weight of food, the weight of the food is a record only 34%. But actually, in China, the real weight of food could record at 42%. Why I say so? Because the food price usually increase very sharply, and the people in the rural area about 60 to 65% of the people still living in rural area. Actually, for them, about 70% of the income just to pay for food. So the government just lowered the weight of the food. That finally, the CPI could be very small. And another point here is housing. The housing is 13%, but actually the housing weight could record at 18%. So as a result, Chinese real GDP growth rate, just became to a little bigger than the real GDP growth rate. So the GDP data is not believable. When we argue something about the Chinese economic performance, we need to discount the data bias. Okay, so let's take a look at Chinese real GDP growth rate. This is official data. Although this is official data, we still can confirm that the GDP growth rate just decline in the past 5 years. Here the problem is that whether the government can enforce some policy mix to sustain the GDP growth rate at 6 to 7%. Actually, Xi Jinping announced last year that China need to sustain the 6.5% on average in the next 5 years. But I think it's very difficult for China because there are no efficient policy mix for the government. The policy will not play the most important role here. I think the government need to do more effort to reform the system. I'll mention later. Okay, this is Keqiang Index. Primarily, Keqiang announced 5 years ago that the Chinese official data is unbelievable. So he account Keqiang Index. What is Keqiang Index? This is transportation by railway and electricity and bank lending. Okay. So I think the Keqiang Index just to show us the real trend of Chinese economy. The problem is how to sustain and support economic development. Chinese government just want to depreciate the yen against the US dollar to strengthen the export industries. In the past decade, that the Chinese renminbi appreciated around 40% against the US dollar. So how to strengthen the competitiveness of the Chinese export manufacturing industry, China need to depreciate the currency. But it's not easy. Why I say so? Because the government, if the government depreciate the currency sharply, then the capital flight could be, very huge and very. It could damage Chinese economy seriously. The appreciation of the renminbi for Chinese rich class is very good. Many Chinese people come to Japan for shopping, but for Chinese macroeconomy, it's not good. But anyway, it's a dilemma for Chinese policymakers. I give you my conclusion that what Chinese government can do for the economy. First of all, I do think that they need to increase the domestic demand, but how to encourage the private consumption, this is a problem. To reform the political system, for example, and to overcome the income disparity, that could be efficient a solution for China to contribute to private consumption. Second one, I think China need to do more effort to reform the SOEs, state-owned enterprises, because the state-owned enterprises, they are very negative to do innovation, R&D. We know that the Chinese economy, the scale is very huge, but we don't know a Chinese brand. What's the Chinese brand? No, we don't know. So Chinese branding strategy will be realized under the reform of the state enterprises, and the Chinese government need to do, you know, improve deregulation and privatize SOEs, and also, you know, strengthen the competition in the market. And the third point here is China need to do more effort to build a real market economy. I don't think that Chinese economy is a real market-oriented economy, because the government usually intervene the market. Such kind of behavior of the government, just will be the problems. Okay. The third, finally, here the point here is to reform the supply side, I mean to reduce the overcapacity, and also to show us the efficient solution about the non-performing loan in state-owned commercial banks. So I think there's a lot of problems. I don't know the roadmap toward the sustainable and stable economic development. So finally, let me mention something about China and Japan relationship. Sometimes some Japanese people, you should ask me that, what do you think about the Chinese status with Japan, or whether Chinese, the Chinese government want to create a stable relationship with China. About the political relationship, I think it's very difficult to estimate. I think about the economic relationship, I do think it's a big chance for Japanese companies. Why I say so? For China, Japanese companies is very important because they have so important technologies. For China, that the domestic companies, they are very negative to do R&D, but they want to collaborate with Japanese companies because they just need the technology. For example, about the vehicle industry, China just want to cooperate with Japanese companies. They want get hybrid technology, for example. So it's a very big chance for Japanese companies to do strengthen the business in Chinese market, and the risk is the political level. So I think the year 2016, Abe administration maybe will have dialogue with Xi Jinping administration. So we need to, manage the risks about the political system. But from the economic view, I think personally, I'm optimistic about the two countries' economic relationship. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Not a very upbeat scenario, I'd say, for the new year. We have risks of a stock market bubble, pollution, believability of the data, market economy problems, and political reform, just to sort of pull out a few of them. Fortunately, the Chinese New Year is actually about a month away, so maybe we'll get better news before then. So let us now open up the floor to questions. The working press goes first. So among working pressers, who would like to ask the first question of either gentleman, please identify yourself. Please specify who you would like to ask the question to. The working press is very shy today. Last chance, working press, non-working press. Okay, there we go, the Italians will come through. They've all been here too long, they're getting Japanese, they don't like to ask questions.
Thank you, my name is Stefano Carrera for the Italian Economic Daily. Recently there is quite a lot of talk about possible Japanization of China. So how high you assess the risk that China today is approaching a Japanese moment like in the 90s, and so the risk that China will go into a tunnel for a decade-long tunnel of low growth and financial sharp adjustment. And the second question is, do you think that the Japanese stock market is more vulnerable to the Chinese factor than other advanced stock market? Thanks.
I think that can go to both of you, yes? Let's see if you agree, disagree. Who wants to go first? Okay. Kano-san, thank you.
Okay, let me start with the China's impact, the impact from China to Japan's macroeconomy. In J.P. Morgan's the global the macroeconometric model, the 1% increase or decline in China's GDP would raise of reduce the Japan's GDP by 0.4%, and compared with the U.S., actually that impact is very limited. And if the Chinese economy slows down, the Japan's export to China would fall. But this is a global phenomenon. Now the global manufacturing industry depends on what happens to the China's industrial production. Japan is no exception at all. But if the Chinese economy slows down, usually we see a fall in the commodity prices, including the oil prices. So this is exactly what we are seeing now. So decline in oil prices would favor the consumption as it increases the real the personal income, especially the older the oil importing countries, including Japan. So in this sense, actually, the fall in the export will be at least in part offset by an increase in the consumption. So this is how I foresee how I see the impact from China on the Japanese economies. Naturally, the stock market tends to respond to even a small change of the external environment, including China. So in this sense, naturally, we see some the downside risk from the decline in the growth rate of China. But my point is not not only about the economy, but the risk from China, from Japan's perspective, is the renminbi. The devaluation of the renminbi would have should have an adverse impact on Japan through the yen appreciation. There is no the direct link between renminbi and yen, but the decline, unexpected devaluation of the renminbi would surprise the rest of the world, and especially it's very bad for the emerging economies. And especially the emerging Asians, they are the competitors in the export market because they are producing the same goods as China. So they have to devalue the currency. And especially if it happens when US interest rates are rising, and they also have the risk of the huge capital outflows. So that to prevent this, the monetary policy in emerging Asia would have to be tightened compared with otherwise. So their economy is slowing down. So we need to see more accommodative monetary policies in emerging Asians, but they can't. So therefore, the unexpected devaluation of renminbi would lead to the global market more risk off. And currently, they're just reflecting the different direction of the monetary policy between Japan and the US. There is a huge the yen short position all over the world. So the risk off tend to make this huge short-term position reduce. So that's the mechanism how the yen strengthens. So therefore, the yen strengthening, actually the weak yen was the main transmission channels of the Kuroda's monetary policy. So I think the Kuroda's monetary policy worked more than I had expected because the yen weakened more than I expected. So if we see some the unexpectedly bad impact from the rest of the world, it would be through the yen appreciation. So then also the stock market is very sensitive to the yen. And so therefore, this is how the stock market, why we saw the sell off the stocks in Japan. And I think it's mainly because of the role of the renminbi.
Okay, Kei-san.
Well, the interdependence of these two countries' economics is very constructive for the two nations, I think. But the problem is about the financial market. The problem is about the real economy, I think. The Japanese companies in China, they just performed very well, I think. Of course, they need to change their business strategy. The problem is the Japanese companies in Japan, they have a business relationship with the Chinese counterparts, but Chinese GDP growth ratio going to slow down, and China just downsize the import. So that will impact to the Japanese companies in Japan. Another point is about the financial market. It's a currency issue. I think Chinese government just want to stabilize the renminbi, Chinese currency. But how to stabilize the currency? The export manufacturing industry for China, competitiveness is very weak now. Chinese government want to strengthen the competitiveness of the export manufacturing industries. But it's not efficient for just only depreciate the currency. So this is a dilemma. I think China need to reform the Chinese companies. I mentioned again. There's easy way for Xi Jinping administration to realize the goal. From a short-term view, I think Chinese GDP growth rate could decline from 6% to 4-5%. That will not only impact on the Japanese economies, but also the East Asian countries like Korean and ASEAN countries regionally. At this point, I think that China and Japan need to do effort to, for example, have a summit with regional nations to dialogue and discuss some cooperation to create some cooperation mechanism to overcome the crisis. Because the interdependence of this in the region is very strong. So something like TPP is okay, but RCEP could be another efficient solution framework. So anyway, I think the two big nations in this region need to do more effort to strengthen the dialogue, I think.
Okay, thank you. It's interesting. It's the first time anyone's mentioned TPP between either of you. How about that? It's all in the news. Other questions from the working press? Okay, they will pass. We'll move on to the wider group. Just a reminder, a long statement of your view followed by what do you think is not a question. So please keep your question to a question. And can we open it up? Who would like to ask a question? Everyone's looking at each other. Don't worry, don't be shy. Ah, that gentleman there, followed by Andy. Come on up to the microphone, sir. He's got a lot of notes with him. I don't know if that's a good or a bad sign.
I'm not going to make a big speech. Makoto Honjo, associate. Question to Kanno-san. You said that there is a potential for real growth in income. On the other hand, you were also saying that the Japanese companies are not investing in CapEx. And that means that the Japanese companies do not see any future in economic growth, and so they're kind of keeping their money. And could you explain any reasoning, rationale for this dichotomy? That's question number one. For Mr. Ka, I have been told that the Li Ka-ching index is very heavily skewed toward heavy industry because of the facts of the factors that they look, and it doesn't sort of really look at what is up and coming in China, the sort of softer side of the economy. And could you, if you have any ideas about how, what you feel is the real sort of growth index, which you could sort of look at China, I would appreciate.
Very good question. Thank you. Kanno-san?
Okay, good question. Thank you very much. The near-term outlook on the consumption is not bad. We expect 1.5% growth in real terms of the consumption, but it's partly supported by the decline in oil prices and also the weak yen. And so to answer your question first, both probably the consumers and the corporations don't believe that this is sustainable. So probably, especially from the corporation side, corporate profit surged last year, but based on the weak yen and the decline in oil prices. But definitely this is a transitory phenomenon, and we shouldn't expect those two things to continue forever. So therefore, that is the main reason why the corporations don't spend money and in Japan. But actually, this does not mean that Japanese corporations don't have enough risk appetite. Look at the number of the M&A activities last year. And there are more and more Japanese companies buying out the non-Japanese companies outside Japan. So this basically means that the Japanese companies find the more investment opportunities outside Japan, not in Japan. And also, in the near-term outlook, the consumption is not so bad. Probably they don't believe that this will last forever. And the typical example is the auto industries, and especially the young generations don't seem to show a big interest in buying the autos. I'm not sure whether this is the phenomena just in Japan or the rest of the world, but the auto companies expect the further shrinking of the domestic market. But auto sales are growing outside Japan, including China and even the U.S. And one example of the shift of the demand. And Japan is a matured economy and aging society, and the people spend more money on the services rather than the goods. Old person don't seem to be keen on buying the luxurious cars. But because there is no inventories in the services. Services, spending on services done instantly. And so there are plenty of the demand or potential demand for the services. So we should expect the more growth in the service industry in Japan rather than the manufacturings. And we expect the main source of or main driver of the capex will be the non-manufacturing industries, including the agriculture. And so we are, in a sense, a transitionary period. And so we hope that we see more investment from the new industries, including agriculture and services. And so in this sense, we argued before the lunchtime what will happen to Japan's property market. I'm quite bullish on Japan's property market, especially in large cities such as Tokyo, Osaka, Nagoya, Sapporo, Fukuoka, et cetera, where we are likely to see more service the businesses, and also we are likely to have more foreign companies coming into Japan. And if so, if we open the door for foreign companies, and we will see more foreign companies coming to Japan, and also there will be a driver of the capex.
Okay, Kei-san.
Yes. Thank you for your question. The two data are not comparative, actually. Why? Because the GDP is a real GDP, and the Ikuja index is a normal data. But the significance of the Ikuja index is that it just shows us the decline trend of Chinese economy. It's a different trend from the real GDP. I think the effects of the Kuchang index, something like, for example, bank lending, the government can intervene the state-owned commercial banks to, for example, request the generation of liquidity. So it's not a market mechanism data. Personally, I usually, go to Beijing for research. Always, go to the same spot to account the trucks. At the same, for example, 1 hour, how many trucks just passing? So it's very interesting for me to get the real feeling of the Chinese economic the performance. And another point for me is to interview some guys in the same hotel. You cannot get the real information from the managers, because they usually tell you the not the real information. You can interview the boys, for example, in the hotel. How many the international conference and how many the guests in the hotel. Well, they will tell you the real information. So I just do some interviews in China at the same spot and same time, and get the real information. And finally, I just usually get the conclusion about my personal view about Chinese economy. So from my personal view and compare with Li Keqiang index, I think that the trend that the Li Keqiang index show us is almost similar, I think. Finally, let me give you a short comment about policy making. I just mentioned that the Chinese government need to do dialogue with the Japanese government. Actually, I think Chinese political leaders, they need to do more effort to dialogue with the market. We don't have election system because we don't have a democracy in China. So the political leaders, they don't know how to dialogue with the market. So this is the real reason that making the panic in the market. The market need the announcement from the policymakers. But the Chinese political leader, they usually refuse to make an announcement about their policy making. I think this is a serious problem in China. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. You're counting trucks in Beijing streets. I can understand why you're worried about your health when you go there. Sounds like a very dangerous enterprise. Mr. Joyce.
Thank you. My name is Andy Joyce, working for MetLife Insurance. This is a question for Mr. Kanno. You mentioned labor reform as potentially significant structural reform later this year once the summer elections are out of the way. I'd just like to ask, what's your view on the content of those reforms? You know, how far do you think the Abe administration will go in order to address some of these imbalances in the labor market? Thanks.
Actually, the government submitted the bill to the previous session and the Diet, and that is what we call the white-collar exemption bill. And unfortunately, the Abe administration spent most of the time just discussing on the national security issues, so they didn't have enough time to discuss it. And the same bill will be submitted to the current session of the Diet. And also, this is likely to be actually carried over to the next the session because of the limit of the time. And so the first is the agenda is this to make this bill pass the Diet. In other words, white collar, I think the definition of the white collar is those with annual income, I forgot the exact number, slightly above 10 million yen. Those are defined as a white collar. And now that they are the compensation should be based on performance rather than working hours. Actually, from your viewpoint, this should be nothing new. This is the natural thing. But in Japan, still many companies will pay the employees just based on working hours rather than the performance. But this is a great first step towards for the labor reform, because basically the problem in Japan is a lack of the labor mobilities. And so this causes a lot of the problems on both sides, the companies and the employees. And the main background is, as I said to you, that this lack of the speciality or some special skills. And so that's why the individuals would have to stick to the current companies. And companies, even if the companies don't want those people, they have to keep them within the companies. So that this is bad for both sides. And so that just the, well, the... so this is the first point. And the second content is this has not been discussed the Diet yet, but there should be a system in which the companies should feel free to lay off people and if needed, and but just in return for the giving them some money. In other words, the layoff should be linked to the some lump sum money, and I work for JP Morgan. I'm very familiar with that, and I'm always facing a risk of being fired. And but at the time, there's a package that we go to the severance package at the time, and so we employees understand this kind of mechanism. But so actually, this is good for the workers, because in most cases, and although the labor law in Japan basically have a very significant. They are constrained on the companies to lay off people, and but in case of the SMEs, actually they can't afford the employees when the business conditions turn bad. So therefore, actually the layoff is just the usual phenomena. But because of the lack of the details in the law, labor law, so the workers at the SME can easily be laid off without being paid at the severance. So this law would basically protect those the poor workers at SMEs. But when I read some article in I forgot the magazine or newspaper, I don't think that this is your newspaper. This is not the article in a qualified newspaper, but this article says, okay, if the labor reform is done, and if you come to your office five minutes later than the rules, then you'll be fired. Then the question follows, do you support the labor reform or not? So then 80 to 90% of the Japanese people say no, thank you, because they are the best, they have the best, some vested interest. And by having those some big the favors, and because their job security is ensured by the current the labor law, but actually the victim is the young people, and especially in early 2000 when the labor market was not so tight, even after they graduate the school, they were not employed as full timers, but just as part timers. And as I said, especially in Japan, hourly wage rate of part-timers less than half of the full-timers. So we had a two-tier market. It's mainly because the full-timers are too much protected by law. So we need to relax this kind of conditions to increase the labor mobilities eventually, or the Japanese version of the income disparities between young and elders and between the new graduates and the existing workers. But unfortunately, the young people don't have the strong voting power, and the existing current workers have that. So without the very strong political will, this won't be solved. So that I expect the Abe administration shows a very strong political will to put this agenda past the Diet.
Sorry, can I?
Oh, absolutely, yes.
I just have a small question to Mr. Kanno. And do you think that FRB will continues to raise the interest rate? Why ask the question? Because I just concern on the impact to our Asian economics, especially China and Hong Kong. They pegged the currency with U.S. dollar. So how do you think about the American financial policy trend?
You say that?
U.S. Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
The first of all, if the pace of the rise in U.S. interest rate is modest and mild, then its impact on Asia will be limited. Mm. So actually, the current situation is not typically bad for Asia. And J.P. Morgan has a view, or had a view, that the Fed will hike the rates four times this year, March, June, September, December. But the recent situation probably is quite challenging, and now whether the Fed will hike the rates in March or not, will be a very close call, and the risky situation is such that if the U.S. inflation rate rises very fast, then the Fed will hike the rates regardless what happens to the rest of the world. Mm-hmm. And this will raise a big risk on the stability of the Asian economies. So therefore, but at the moment, there is no such a sign of rise in inflation rate in the U.S., so therefore, there was still that this situation is better than the otherwise, in my view.
Thank you.
Thank you. We have time for one more question or two more questions from the floor. Anyone? Yes. Oh, back to the working press. We keep track of these things.
My name is Patrick Walter. I'm with German newspaper Frankfurter Allgemeine Zeitung. Mr. Kanno, I'm wondering, can you give us your outlook on the current situation? How is this going to end, or what is needed for this uncertainty on the stock markets to end? And maybe, I know it's a difficult bet, but maybe you can give us your expectations how the Japanese stock market is going to develop this year under these new conditions. I mean, there had been some ideas to end at 22,000 at the end of the year. Maybe you have a better guess right now.
Okay. My view is that the market appears to be excessively responding to the bad news from outside Japan. Naturally, it is quite reasonable to respond negatively to the unexpected events such as a rise in the geopolitical risk in the Middle East, North Korea, decline in oil prices, and the devaluation of renminbi. I agree with Mr. Ki-Long's view that the Chinese economy is not so bad. And the Chinese economy disappointed and in the third quarter last year. But as Chinese government implemented the package in August, and they cut the tax on small cars, autos, and the auto sales surged in October and November. Actually, the economic data coming out of China in December was quite good. And the next week we have the another round of the China's December data publishment. And so weeks, if those data are better than expected, then the market would be feel more comfortable. And so first we want to see the stabilization of the Chinese market and the success in Chinese government the efforts to support the economies. This is the first one. And I don't know what will happen to the oil prices. I'm not a specialist on the commodities, but as you know, that the decline in oil prices have a sort of the double-edged sword. Naturally, this is bad for the commodity exporting countries, but this is good for the consumptions. So we hope that because of the decline in energy prices, the consumption in the US and Europe and Japan will be supported. And unexpectedly the yen strengthened too much, for example, below 115, then the Japanese or the BOJ should take any action to stop it. So from Japan side, and we need to send out a more positive message on the two fronts. One is a monetary policy, but this is a short term the measures to cope with those unfavorable events from outside Japan. And also the government should keep announcing to the rest of the world that Abe administration has a very strong political will to push the reform agenda. Then actually, because other than Japan, there is no great announcement on the supply side reform. It's only Japan. And actually, I have a great advantage of meeting the investors of all over the world. Still, there are a great number of the investors who showed interest in Japan's reforms. So the Abe should continue to send out the same message that we will push those reform agenda, and not only this year, but from now on. Then actually the stock and so those investors would find it a great opportunity to buy low, and so the stock market would be supported also by the global investors and also the Japanese investors as well.
Okay, let me do one quick question to Mr. K. You also talked a lot about the downside risks of China. We'd like to end on a happy note. As you economists call it, are there any upside risks to the Chinese economy this year?
Well, I don't think that the Chinese economy is going to crash, but we do have a lot of problems. I just mentioned again. What's the priority of the policy in the Chinese political leaders? I think they need to give a clear message about the policy mix, first of all. And the second one is the policy or the reform Chinese government, need to show us the roadmap to create, for example, the real market or an economy, for example. So I think to sustain the economic development, it's very important to reform, not only to enforce the policy, for example, to lower interest rate or to strengthen the fiscal investment. The final point here is about the currency policy, foreign exchange policy. I just want to say that we experienced the currency crisis in 1997. We find that Chinese foreign reserve just declined so sharply in the past 1 year. So I know this is a dilemma for the central bank, But if the government postponed the reform of the financial system and the underground banking system will play an important role to contribute to capital flight to tax haven United States, it's a potential risk for a Chinese economy structurally.
Okay. So we have lower growth, Middle East violence, North Korean nuclear weapons, currency wars, falling markets. On that happy note, despite all of this bad news, our guests get a gift for coming today. Kanno-san, thank you very much. Here is a one-year honor. Oh, no, stay seated, that's okay. One-year honorary membership in the FCCJ. Thank you very much. And Kei-san,
yes.
Since you were already kind enough to be a member, your gift is more concrete, shall we say.
Although
it is liquid in form. So please, a round of applause. Yes. So thank you all very much for coming. It was a fascinating session today. I hope you all enjoyed it and look forward to seeing you all again soon. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.